good day and happy new year. It's exciting to be here this year again, presenting this to us. I trust that in the course of 2018 that the Lord indeed blessed us bountifully by reason of his word. We are hoping that this year will ascend to greater heights in the place of the word of God. Today we'll be introducing our theme for this year, which centers on godly leadership, politics, and Christian discipleship. We'll be introducing the theme today, and we have our fathers in the Lord to help us do justice to this very important topic, especially at this time that our country is going into the general elections. By my right is Venerable Annexed Onoha. He is the vicar, All Saints Anglican Church, we say, here in Abuja Diocese. Sir, you're welcome to the program.
Thank you very much. Welcome, viewers.
And by my left is Venerable Kingsley Obu. He is the PA to the primate of our church and the chaplain, Chapel of Resurrection, also here in Abuja Diocese. You're welcome to the program, sir.
Thank you, viewers, and welcome to the program.
Yeah. Our aims will be to help us grasp the meaning of this theme. Remember, the theme says godly leadership, politics, and Christian discipleship. Secondly, to recognize godly leadership. And finally, to be challenged to have a desire to raise godly leaders. We'll quickly take our background text. Venerable sir, I invite you to help us read Daniel chapter 4, verse 24 to 27. And Venerable, Luke chapter 12, 42 to 47, quickly.
Okay, it says, this is the interpretation of O King, and this is the decree of the Most High, which has come upon my Lord the King. They shall drive you from men. Your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and they shall make you eat grass like oxen. They shall wet you with the dew of heaven, and seven times shall pass over you, till you know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whomever he chooses. And inasmuch as they gave the command to leave the stump and roots of the tree, your kingdom shall be assured to you after you come to know that heaven rules. Therefore, O King, let my advice be acceptable to you. Break off your sins by being righteous, and your iniquities by showing mercy to the poor. Perhaps there may be a lengthening of your prosperity. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Venerable sir.
Luke chapter 12, verses 42 to 47. The Lord answered, who then is the faithful and wise manager, whom the master puts in charge of his servants to give them their food allowance at the proper time? It will be good for that servant when the master finds doing so when he returns. I tell you the truth, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But suppose the servant says to himself, my master is taking a long time in coming, and he then begins to beat the men servants and maid servants and to eat and drink and get drunk. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him and at an hour he is not aware of. He will cut him in pieces and assign him a place with the unbelievers. That servant who knows his master's will and does not get ready or does not do what his master wants will be beaten with many blows. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Introduction. The call for godly leadership in the political arena and Christian discipleship may be indicative of a society that has strayed from God's pattern and ordained style of leadership. What then is leadership? It is the capacity of someone to lead others. Having or occupying the position as a leader of a group, organization, etc. Godly leadership is the leadership that recognizes that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whomever he chooses. That we saw clearly in Daniel chapter 4, verse 25, where our Father in the Lord just read. And knows that heaven rules. also in Daniel chapter 4, verse 26. I think this topic is central. All through scriptures, we find out that leadership is one of the cardinal instruments with which men are raised. And we are trusting that at such a time as this in our country, that the Lord will help us, even in the church. What's the place of the church in politics? That God will help us to raise men and women that will stand in the gap. Women that will be like Deborah, the wife of Lapidot, and men that will be like David, who rose to the occasion in their time, leading God's people. The cardinal question in this study, when then, is with so many leaders lacking in godly virtues of humility and selflessness, has human society not been engulfed by ungodly leadership? That's a question for you and I to ponder. But we trust that the Lord will grant us illumination as we discuss further in the name of Jesus. Yeah. Amen. Quickly, we look at the study guide. Venerable, what does godly leadership mean to you as individual and as a church? Let's look at Mark chapter 10, verse 42 to 45. We've read Luke chapter 12 as our background text. So let's look at Mark now. Mark 10, 42 to 45, and then your response, sir.
But Jesus called to himself and said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. Mm. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. Mm. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many.
So, sir, what does godly leadership mean to us as individuals and corporately as a church?
Yes, for us as individuals, the godly leadership here in the context we are talking about, we are talking about the leadership that borders on a fear of God.
Exactly.
For men and women to know that God is involved in affairs of men. Mm. God is not what we say in Latin, Deus absconditus. He's not a withdrawn God. God is involved. Mm. Even in Romans chapter 13, he set up governments.
Exactly.
And said people should also be subject to authority. So if we recognize this from onset, as leaders, as those that are being led, that leadership revolves around fear of God.
Exactly.
God is not to be jettisoned, not to be pushed aside. Mm. He is part and parcel. You can now see the byproduct of that leadership, because the source is from God.
Exactly.
The number two, beyond fear of God, is that is one that is also predicated along the line of humility. Mm. Jesus, our Master, our Savior, gave us the template.
Exactly.
Said the Son of Man came to serve
and not to be served.
But you know, in the worldly context, people are clamoring for position, for leadership. They are just going there to be seen and not to
serve.
Stand in the gap for the people. Mm. They may claim to be leaders, but they are leading themselves.
Mm.
But when you see it from the point of view of the Bible, God himself took the form of a servant in order to draw humanity to himself. So anyone that should now lead God's people as an individual or in the church must come out to serve in humility. And in fact, Jesus situated it there. Whoever wants to be the greatest must be the servant. So if this servanthood is understood, I think we have no problem as individuals and then within the wider context of the church.
Thank you very much, sir. Venerable, you want to?
Yeah, let me quickly add that godly leadership is that leadership where men recognize the fact that they are merely representing God in leading people.
Exactly.
In whatever sphere, whether religious or political. Mm. If he's going to be godly, the leader must know and see himself as representing God. Therefore, the will of God matters.
Mm. So that's accountability to God. Yeah. must be very pivotal and key. You know, Venerable, when you were talking, I love that Latin phrase. You say, Deus absconditus.
That God being withdrawn.
He's not a withdrawn God. You know, it made me remember one of the biography of Desmond Tutu that I read. He was making a case about liberation theology and talked about the book of Exodus, that God was involved in liberating his people from the hands of Pharaoh, that he was not a withdrawn God. That was the text, the term he used, that he was not a God who was distant or withdrawn, but he got himself, he raised leaders who was able to lead his people out. So child of God, this year, we are trusting so mightily that God is not withdrawn in the affairs of our country, and that as we look into leadership, even as we move into the next round of election, that God will show himself strong on our behalf in the name of Jesus. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Venerable, let's look at question two. In Daniel chapter 4, 24 to 27, we'll not read that because we've taken it as a background test. Mm-hmm. And all of those are scriptures referenced there. Mention and discuss some traits of godly leadership. I invite you to help us read Philippians chapter 2, verse 4, while I'll read Mark chapter 10, 41 to 47.
All right, Philippians chapter 2, verse 4. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others.
Awesome. Mark chapter 10, let me re-echo that so that you will build your response from there also. Mark chapter 10, verse 41 says, and when the ten heard it, they began to be greatly displeased with James and John. But Jesus called them to himself and said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant, and whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. So what are some of the traits we can pick from these passages, including all those that we couldn't read, in discussing godly leadership?
Yeah, thank you. When we talk about traits, it also means characteristics.
Exactly, sir.
You know, some features you can see, and you can say this is godly leadership. Number one is humility. If a leader is godly, humility will be very evident.
Exactly, sir.
He'll be humble. The next one is service. Service will be uppermost. And in that kind of service, he serves as a servant. You know, he's there as a servant, like Jesus said, not to lord it over the people others committed to his charge. He's there as a servant. And another characteristic is selflessness. You know, he said in that Philippians chapter 2, verse 4, we should not only look for our own interest,
but for the interest.
You should think of others as well. So where there is godly leadership, the interest of the masses, the interest of the subjects is considered and, in fact, put first. And that makes godly leadership a very sacrificial thing.
Exactly.
Another one is there should be mercy in dealing with the subjects. You know, when the interpretation was given to the king in Daniel, he told him, now I advise you, and I plead you take my advice to break away from your evil
ways.
And then to show mercy on your subjects. So the mercy is part of it that shows that this is godly leadership. And then promoting of righteousness. A leader cannot be an evil man and then expect the subjects to be righteous. It cannot. It cannot happen. You know, so they should be merciful, and then it should be righteous and should be seen to be so.
Thank you very much, sir. You know that last line you were adding, every organization mirrors its leadership.
Faithfulness is another critical point in service. How faithful. And this is one of such things that our people, gradually they are losing sight of. Because you go there, but you are not faithful. But Jesus will always say, well done, good and faithful servant. So the degree of faithfulness, when you entrust people with leadership position, whether in the church or in the society or in any organization, so how faithful are they? And when you see them, they are reliable, they are dependable. I think another aspect of this is integrity, serving people with integrity. Black is black. White is white. And this is what we are missing within the Christendom and even in the wider society. Many people are serving, but without integrity. And we say that in conventional statement, we say, when integrity is lost, all is lost. Jesus had integrity. And the disciples looked upon him. He was able to gather them and then replicated himself in them. But we have leaders. But do they have integrity? When you entrust them with money, when you entrust them with certain resources to share, at the end of the day, stories are being told. And I think we need to talk about it more now that we are going into a new era. Because the old era, we have seen men occupying positions without integrity. And it's a very sad commentary.
And these are evident all around us. You know, people would have traveled this Christmas season that just ended, coming back for the new year. Look at the state of the roads. You go to hospitals, there are men who receive allocations, and then these things are not being provided. I pray that God will touch someone out there. You are there, you're a political leader. You're even a leader maybe in that small corner where you are, but you have a sphere of influence that God will touch you by reason of this study. Talking about faithfulness, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, St. Paul speaking said, let a man so consider us, verse 1, as servants of Christ, and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in servants that they be found faithful. That's the word of God. I pray that God will help us in the place of faithfulness in the name of Jesus. Yeah. Amen. Question 3. Let's define and discuss the following about godly leadership. The first point to note there is to look at some of the characteristics of ungodly leadership. I think we've looked at it in passing, but let's dwell narrow down more on it now. Why and how to raise godly leadership? And then godly leadership in relation to Christian discipleship. Venerable sir.
Yes, some indices of ungodly leadership. Then you can talk about corruption. In fact, we have a grading. We call the nibblers, the chewers, and the gobblers in corruption. Those who nibble, they take very little. Then those who, they take very little higher than that, the chewers. Then you have the highest.
The gobblers.
So you see that ungodly leadership will always exhibit that. People feel this is our time. In fact, nobody climbs on top of the Iroko without the gathering. They are not looking at the wider implication. So in ungodly leadership, what is paramount is this idea of corruption. Grab as much as you can. Then number two.
That corruption stuff is important because it's one of the bane of our present day society. You know, when you look at the corruption perception index for our country, I don't think we've made much progress. In spite of the fact that the government in power came and one of the three cardinal points of their focus is the fight against corruption. So it's key we know.
Yes, that one is in paper, not in theory. You know, you can structure to win people.
Exactly.
But already they know where they are going. If not, how come we are recycling corruption upon corruption? And I think through this our Bible study, we pray that God will raise men and women.
Exactly.
Who will give a new direction. But as it is presently, not that all hopes are totally lost, but this is the grading. People are there for what they can get out of the system. Then number two, there is an element of intimidation.
Exactly.
You know, when you are leading a people and they're always afraid of you, you ditch elders, you force it down their throat. It's ungodly. God, leadership is about influence, about leading the people.
Yeah.
You have a goal and a result to obtain at the end of the day. But when it is obtained under duress under intimidation,
coercion, and
it is not good. And people will not give their best. the idea of creativity is suppressed. Because
everybody is afraid
of the big man and so on. So these are some of the things you see: wickedness, lawlessness, idolatry, and so on and so forth. These are threats because people want to be there out of what they can make out of the system, not for the common good of the people.
Thank you very much, sir.
Then when you now turn to the aspect of why do we need godly leadership? Of course, we need them so that they can redirect, so that they will teach the wider society that God is really involved in the affairs of men. And this is very, very essential. The king, Nebuchadnezzar, was taught this far. So until you come back to your senses, things could be restored.
Exactly.
So if people now know why we need godly leadership, you know, they go that way, they give God room to operate in their lives. The economy will improve.
Exactly.
The health system will improve. The social. No, we don't talk about strikes again, whether labor or no labor, minimum wage or not, things will naturally improve. Take its course.
And our country will not be the poverty capital of the world.
Yes.
I think we'll come back after the break to continue the discussion. Mm-hmm. I trust that by reason of this study, God will restore honest integrity in our sanctuaries of power and in our places of governance. God bless you.
We want to thank you for always tuning in to our numerous value-adding and impactful programs. We cannot overemphasize your comments and views on our social media platforms. They've been really, really encouraging and shaping us to do better. My name is Samuel Iyola. In the course of improving our quality and coverage, we have upgraded our broadcast format from MPEG-2 to MP4. This is to improve the quality of the video you watch and also enable you, our esteemed viewers, to watch us anywhere you are in the world using your mobile phones. To keep watching ACNN, the simple step you need to take is to perform an auto scan on your HD decoder. If you don't know how to go about this, just follow these simple steps. Press Menu on the remote controller of your decoder. Select Installation Menu. Press OK. Scroll down to Auto Scan and press OK. If you want to delete all existing channels on your decoder and scan them again, choose the Yes option. Else, choose No to add new channels to the existing ones. Press OK and sit back while your decoder scans through the available channels. Your decoder will automatically quit the screen when scanning is completed. If this is not the case, press Exit button until you get out of the menu screen. Go to the list of available channels by pressing OK and search for the new ACNN channel with the TV suffix. That's all. If you find this procedure difficult, contact any satellite dish installer around you. Up on the solid rock. However, if you don't have a free-to-air decoder that supports this format, then you may need to get another decoder that supports this by contacting any satellite dish installer or vendor around you. Well, we're happy to inform you that you can now watch all our programs on your mobile devices as well as your laptops. Just visit our website at acnntv.com/live from any device. And you can also watch us live anytime, any day via your laptop by logging in to facebook.com/acnntv and click on the live TV link on the left-hand side of your screen. Always remember that we will at all times bring to you the undiluted Word of God. Stay blessed.
Welcome back, viewers. We trust that you've been blessed thus far by reason of this study. Remember, we are looking at godly leadership, politics, and Christian discipleship. We need to grow men and women who will honor God when they are placed in places of leadership and authority. And I've had with me thus far in the studio our fathers and the Lord, Venerable Ernest Onoha and Venerable Kingsley Obu. Venerable sir,
yes,
I still stay with you. Let's look at that point number C in question 3. Godly leadership in relation to Christian discipleship.
Okay, before returning to that, I wanted to add one point on how to raise godly leadership. You know, I'm thinking in terms of mentoring.
Mm.
We need to mentor people.
Mm.
Because you hand down, you try to pass on. Jesus gathered the disciples, he stayed with them, and he taught
exactly.
them.
Exactly.
When Elijah recruited Elisha, in fact, at a point, Elisha was pouring water into his hand.
Exactly.
And then you look at the one we also read in the Old Testament about Moses. He said Moses was a servant of God, but Joshua was a servant of Moses. You can see how they had time to stay together. And when Moses died, Israel mourned for him, but there was no contest. There was a smooth transition.
No vacuum.
Although Joshua and Caleb, they formed the minority people that surveyed the land. But when it came to leadership, people saw Joshua as the servant of Moses, and he quickly stepped in. There was continuity. He now led the people to the promised land. So if you mentor, if you teach, if you have time to pass on, that is the way the modern society, future Nigeria, future churches could be sustained. You appear in the scene, you have nobody. You know, later we blamed Elisha. Having been raised by somebody, he didn't raise it. He died with his power. And that is very fatal. So mentoring will be a way of helping to raise godly leaders.
Then Gehazi would have stepped in for Elisha, but he
on his own. Then by godly leadership in relation to Christian discipleship, and it's partly the way I'm reacting to, you now see that there is need for replication.
Exactly.
There must be time to tutor, to coach, to guide, so that what you have will not be lost easily. When you look at leadership and you prepare people, transition is easier. When you do discipling, the one that is discipled will disciple other people.
Exactly.
And there will be Jesus did it.
Mm-hmm.
The disciples also had time. And even today, we also teach and talk about soul, but we are not seeing much to the effect that when people finish, when they are gone from the scene, you don't hear much about their legacies and so on. Yet in the political tools are going, say, he's my mentor. This man is mine. But the ideas are not being sustained.
Because it's a very valid point you're raising. Succession planning is a big issue in the church and even in the larger society. We've seen leaders in Africa that have stayed for donkey years and they've not had worthy mentors to take over. We've seen leaders who are leading churches even in contemporary Nigeria and they've been on the stage for quite a long.
What's the problem in such leadership where people stay in for donkey years and they don't have worthy successors?
Some of our African leaders, they have no plans to hand over. So they won't mentor anybody.
Wow, that's tragic.
And even if they see somebody who they know can, they will strategize not to. You know, so theirs is a peculiar case.
Mm.
Yeah, but then in the church, where you have a leader who stays there for donkey years, and then if for any reason he's no longer found, there's already a family structure to continue. See, that is their own. That is their government. That is what they want it.
Mm.
And anybody you find under that leadership will not complain.
Mm.
Because if you complain, of course they place you somewhere. So it's really bad.
It was a mixed bag of experiences for even for the political parties in the last party primaries. People wanting to bring on board their stooges. That's not good leadership. And sometimes it pains you because these are people that are in churches on Sunday. These are people that are Christians, and then you begin to see how
so-called Christians, because they are churchgoers.
We must get it right in leadership. John Maxwell said everything rises and falls on leadership. If we don't get it right, the society will be complaining that churches are filled on Sundays, but within the week you see men misbehaving. Venerable, let me get back to you. Let's look at those two last points. What do godly leadership and politics share in common? This is very important because you see some Christians who will stay aloof and say it doesn't concern us. Politics is for the evil men. Some of us may not even have gotten our PVC and we are preparing for election. What do godly leadership share in common with politics?
Thank you very much. The understanding of many Christians has actually affected the role of Christians in politics for years in Nigeria and maybe some other countries. Politics, if it is bad or evil, is because it's played by evil people.
Evil men. So we need clean men to make it clean.
If clean men should get involved in it, then automatically it can become clean.
Exactly.
So, but the tragedy is that when supposedly clean men get into politics, politics converts them and they become like others.
And you'll be wondering, what is it that politics that makes them?
Yeah. It's all about selfishness. Mm. People not willing to make sacrifice, to lose what should be lost. They want to gain everything.
Mm.
So looking at this now, what do godly leadership and politics share in common? You see that politics is about leadership.
Mm.
And there's a mistake they often make in worldly politics. They want to say, this is politics.
Yes.
Remove God from it.
Remove God aside. Yeah.
You know, which is a very big mistake.
Mm.
Because it is God who makes leadership. It is God who establishes leadership. You cannot now be in leadership and say, because it's not in the church. They will tell you, take that one to the church.
Or take it to your... Politics are not,
this is politics. Yeah. This is society.
Mm.
You know, but God is the one in charge of leadership. So there is need for godly leadership to be seen in politics.
Mm.
If those who are there recognize that they are not the best after all in the whole nation, they are not the best. One factor or the other played,
time and chance,
and then they came up. Yes, the race is not for
the
swift.
Exactly.
Neither is the battle for the strong. Mm. You know, so if they recognize that and then they see it as God placing them there, then they will see the need to bring godly leadership into politics.
Thank you very much.
The prayer of our Lord, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," can only happen when godly leaders are there. They will allow the will of God to distill and be seen among men.
So they need to understand the purpose, why they are there, at a particular time.
And that it is God, not because they campaign very well. So somebody in this country won election and died before swearing in.
Exactly, on the eve of his glory. Look at Mordecai telling Esther, who knows whether you've come to the kingdom at such a time as this? So people need to be conscious of the reason why they are there at a particular time.
You know, the word to be conscious is very essential, yes. But, you know, we place a caution because religion and politics, when they miss, it's like fire and oil. If people don't understand this and go into it, at the end, they are neither here nor there. The thing is that, granted, in Romans 13, God gives power to whomever he wishes. But in the real political sense, students of politics, they know what I'm going to say now. Politics is about struggle for power. And they don't believe that people or God gives it, you must struggle. In fact, in your first tenure, you may be an innocent lamb. But in second tenure, you have tasted it. Power. position, resources. And you know, when people struggle, the bottom line of the struggle is sharing of resources. That's why when they get in there, either they are messed up by the system or the system will mess them up. Because immediately you emerge, the leader will not determine, will determine the sharing of resources. Let me recall, in a democratic setup, Montesquieu was a French philosopher.
Yes, sir.
And he so did it that there will be a kind of separation of powers, where you have the executive, you have the judiciary, and the legislature. And they will have their checks and balances. But because the executive will have, you know, access to resources, then he will not be playing with the judiciary
and the legislature.
That is why you see them, whether they gather national or whatever, for them to pass bills and some of these things, money will be involved. So at the end of the day, you may stand yourself because you want to take home certain resources. Nobody will believe your story because you have struggled, you have spent money sharing rights, sharing this before getting, you must recover. So when people struggle in that dimension, they lose sight. But if ordinarily that God gives it, and somebody will understand it from that perspective, freely you are giving, freely you will
that
also.
That understanding is key, because
when people struggle
there are
for
men
it,
who have still struggled, and at the end of the day, they didn't get it. They've campaigned, spent money.
God is still the ultimate giver
at the end of the day. And that understanding needs to be emphasized, that we shouldn't sacrifice morality, integrity, and honesty as Christians on the altar of seeking political
power. That's why we need to ask the church to do as we are doing now.
Yes.
If not in the ordinary political field, it's about struggle.
Exactly.
Who controls what?
What?
And
in
so
fact,
on and
one
so
political
forth.
Scientist in UNN defined it. He said politics is about power, rather, say, is about who gets what, when, and how. Mm-hmm. I think that was Professor Fokan Weke nowadays in school. So, but child of God, God still gives power. Bible says promotion cometh neither from the east nor from the west. But the race, like Venerable said, is not to the swift. That's the scripture. Time and chance happens. Just trust God when it is your time. Things will turn around for you. Now, the last point. Why should we desire to raise godly leaders?
And leadership.
Let's read Proverbs chapter 29, verse 2. And then Proverbs 14, 33. I think that's very popular. Righteousness is
exalted.
Proverbs 29,
verse 2 says, when the righteous strive, the people rejoice. Hmm. When the wicked rule, the people groan.
Wow. Very striking. When the wicked rules, the people groan. Venerable sir.
So when we talk about this question, why should we desire? I think the response is very obvious. You know, most times you now ask yourself, when people are groaning under a leadership, can it be automatic that leadership is wicked? You know, this can be another side of it.
Yes.
But we need to desire godly leadership so that we can have righteous people on the throne. When the righteous man is on the throne, he will say no to certain things because he will walk by conviction, not based on what comes to me.
Title, position, boss.
Variable was talking about corruption before. Our system is so bad that if, as you are seated here now, you are elected something, even if it's counselor, your community automatically counts you out of poverty. It's a problem.
It's a problem, yeah. Very systemic.
A very big one. So they look up to you to do something, to bring money, to do this. And when you start doing it for them, it is normal. They don't care how much is your salary. How much is your allowance? It is normal. And if you don't do it, they will send delegation to you. Say, are you the first?
In fact, I heard about
they can organize a reception because there they will read address to drum such a hope into your ears. This is our time.
In fact, I heard about one of the ministers who in his first experience
in whether it was in the Third or Second Republic,
yeah.
when he finished and got home, people were like almost wanting to stone him. You got there.
Because he didn't deliver.
So when he got the second opportunity now, and he was like, I'm not going home and empty-handed. I must go back to my people with something. That so is a problem.
That
in
is a problem.
Point.
Then we forget that righteousness is what exalts a nation.
Mm.
Today now, look at our economy, look at the system. People, we will be given contract. Before the money for the contract gets to the final person to do the job,
taking up front.
Half of the money is gone. Now, the person goes there and does anything and goes away because he also had to make some profit. Then, after about 6 months or 1 year, the road is getting dilapidated. The people that should have said, why this, will keep quiet because they have taken something. So, it's a big problem. So, we need righteous leadership. We need godly leadership that will be willing to consider the interest of the masses and not just selfish
Settle down for momentary gains. Look at
it. Is not our wish that our leaders, after leading us, should come back and become poor people. That's not our wish. But at the same time, we are not we are not expecting them to go there and impoverish us.
Exactly.
And become rich.
Exactly.
There should be a balance. There should be godliness
exactly.
in leadership.
No, leadership is about providing the greatest number of goods for the greatest number of people. So in as much as we don't expect them to be poor, we still expect them, because this community is what makes us strong. When we have these infrastructures, our country will become the better for it. I trust that God is already charging you up to go out there and do your bit, I do my bit, and our country will not just be a potentially great nation, but will become a great nation indeed. Let's look at the conclusion. Christians ought to always remember that all authority and power that leadership position confers on us are for us to provide godly leadership wherever we are and in our respective levels of service. You may be a market woman out there. You may be a student union president. You may be a leader in the church, a pastor. You may be a political leader, a governor, a senator. Remember that the ultimate is service. In fact, Albert Pike, one philosopher, said that the best of men on earth are those who serve others. Food for thought. Acknowledge heaven's rule and you have the key to a meaningful rule on earth. Our memory verse, Luke chapter 12, verse 43. We quickly read that together. Luke 12, 43. Okay. Let's read together.
Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes.
Blessed is that servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. I pray that the Lord will find you servant when he comes. We trust that today has been a blessing. Like I said, this is the first edition in this year, and this year is going to be glorious. Wherever you find yourself, a leader, a follower, I pray that God will find you faithful. This is coming to you from the Anglican Cable Network. Our commitment is to continue to share the undiluted word of God to the utmost ends of the earth. And if the Lord will lead you to partner with us this year, we welcome you. Our addresses are scrolling right now, our social media, our phone number handles, those scrolling on your screen right now. Get across to us, and together in partnership, we will share the light of the word of God to the ends of the earth. We want to thank our resource persons today, Venerable NX Onoha. Thank you for your perspective.
Mm.
Pray that the Lord will continually keep you safe and make the boundary lines fall unto you in pleasant places in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Thank you very much.
Thank you for this honor. We trust that the Lord will equally find you worthy as Thank he you. Uses you mightily in his church.
Amen.
Until we come back to you next time, keep on leading and keep on serving. God bless you. Lord, I want